Simon & Schuster Audio presents Spy School Project X, a spy school novel by Stuart Gibbs, read by Gibson Frazier.
For the Fabulous Kate Grant. To my evil friends around the world. From Murray Hill. If you are receiving this email, then things have gone horribly wrong with my most recent evil plan. I set up my account to automatically send this email to all of you today unless I stopped it from transmitting. And since I haven't stopped it, that means we have a problem. Yes, I said we there, not just me. All of us have a problem. His name is Benjamin Ripley. I know Ripley is only a teenager, but he has already helped thwart many of your brilliant evil plans. And if he hasn't thwarted yours, then you certainly know someone whose plans he has thwarted. Frankly, I'm sick of it. If it wasn't for Ripley, a lot of us would be very, very rich. But now, we're not. And to make matters worse, other bad things have befallen us. Some of us have been captured. Some have lost body parts. And some have nearly died multiple times. This has to stop. I have talked to all of you about Project X before. The time has come to initiate it. If you are reading this email, consider yourselves activated. May the best person win. Your friend, Murray Hill. P.S. Ben Ripley sucks.
June 10th. From the principal to Benjamin Ripley. Benjamin, I need to meet you at 1200 hours tomorrow. This is urgent, and also really important. The meeting will be in my office, in the Hale Administration Building, the office that you blew up at the beginning of the school year. I know that you will be busy with your final exams, but it is critical that you attend. Your life depends on it. This meeting will be top secret. Tell no one about it. And destroy this message after reading it. The Principal.
Chapter 1. Self-Preservation. Lyman Gymnasium. The CIA's Academy of Espionage. Washington, D.C. June 11th, 1200 hours. I had an emergency meeting with the principal. As if finals at spy school weren't stressful enough. I used to go to a normal middle school, so I'm aware that exam weeks everywhere are difficult, but ours was brutal. Not just mentally, but often physically as well. For example, an algebra exam in regular middle school might have a few questions on working out parabolas, while an algebra exam at spy school entailed having live grenades lobbed at you. The grenades were loaded with paint instead of explosives, so they would merely color you blue rather than blow your limbs off. But still, the test was so traumatic, it frequently left students gibbering in fear. I'm lucky enough to be gifted in mathematics, and yet there's a very big difference between doing a complex equation in a nice, quiet classroom as opposed to a muddy foxhole with paint-filled explosives raining down on you. And that was one of the easier exams. The most difficult was in advanced self-preservation. It also happened to be the most painful. Well, it wasn't painful if you were good at self-preservation. In that case, The exam could be rather hazardous for your instructor, but I wasn't good at self-preservation at all. Everyone has their strengths. Mine happened to be more cerebral. I'm quite skilled at deducing what bad guys are plotting and then figuring out how to defeat them. This wasn't only in a classroom setting. I had faced actual bad guys a surprising number of times, given that I was only in my second year of spy school. Due to some extraordinary circumstances, I had managed to prevent evil organizations from dismantling the planet's electrical grid, destroying the Panama Canal, assassinating the President of the United States, and melting Antarctica. And that was just in the spring semester. Unfortunately, at spy school, we didn't get good grades for successful missions. In fact, we still had to make up the homework we missed while we were away. To be honest, I've gotten much better at self-preservation since coming to spy school. I could probably defeat the average person in a fight. But when you're a spy, you don't get attacked by average people. You have trained killers come after you. And so, to properly prepare us for the field, the exams in advanced self-preservation were extremely difficult. The final involved a little-known Tibetan style of martial arts known as Nuk Ban San, which loosely translates as, "Wow, that really hurts." Each student had to fight one of the academy's many martial arts instructors. If we could defeat them, we would get an A. Personally, I felt that was highly unlikely. The best I could hope for was a D, which involved losing the fight but not getting sent to the school infirmary. I would have been nervous enough about the self-preservation exam on a normal day, but the impending meeting with the principal made everything worse. The principal had two basic personalities, angry and incompetent, and he tended to swing back and forth between them without any warning at all. So being with him was never a pleasant experience. He also had said that my life depended on this meeting, which made me even more anxious. Then, to top things off, Professor Crandall had been late for the exam. Crandall was an elderly and doddering instructor with a big secret. In truth, he was very aware and capable, but only pretended to be in decline to throw off his enemies. I was one of the few people who knew this, having learned of it during my first mission, and had sworn not to tell anyone. Crandall was exceptionally good at the doddering act, and his lectures were famous for being incredibly boring and only vaguely coherent. In his final class of the semester, he had rambled on for a half hour about how to protect yourself against Vikings, even though the last time they had been a threat was 1000 AD. The exam took place in the school gymnasium. Two students at a time were paired with instructors to fight. Crandall sat in the stands, ostensibly watching the proceedings, although he seemed to keep nodding off. Like I said, he was a very good actor. Normally, I would have been in no rush to get my butt kicked, but I was hoping to go early so that I could still make my meeting with the principal. Instead, I was placed in the final pairing. By then, I knew there was very little chance that I would get to the meeting on time, which would certainly incur the wrath of the principal. I never enjoyed incurring wrath, but the only way to be punctual would be to throw my exam. That would be extremely painful, and I enjoyed pain even less than wrath. Also, I didn't want to get an F in self-preservation and have to take the course over again the next semester. So I tried my best. The student who was selected to compete at the same time as me was Zoe Zibble. For much of my time at spy school, Zoe had been my closest friend, although we had recently hit a bumpy patch. Zoe had thought that one of our fellow students had switched to working for the bad guys and had gone behind my back to try to have them arrested. Her intentions were good, although she was wrong about the other student, but I had felt betrayed. Zoe had apologized profusely, and I knew she meant it, yet things were still awkward between us. Zoe didn't look impressive physically, being small and slight of build, but she was a formidable fighter. Plus, her size sometimes worked to her advantage. Her opponent, a wiry, muscular instructor, had certainly been told not to underestimate her. And then he did it anyhow. In under a minute, Zoe had him pinned to the mat and howling in pain. An A-plus performance for sure. My own exam didn't go nearly as well. I was matched against a young woman with muscles so taut they looked like iron bands. I started out decently well, employing a nukbansan move called fast as lightning. This wasn't really an attack. Instead, I just darted about quickly in an unpredictable pattern, hoping that my opponent might grow tired of chasing me around before she got the chance to hurt me. It wasn't the sort of technique that earned you an A, but then it was a lot less painful than staying put and getting punched in the nose. Unfortunately, my opponent responded with a move called Even Faster Than Lightning, where she simply moved quicker than I did, then locked her hand around my wrist with the grip of extreme stickiness and unleashed the ordeal of 1,000 smacks to the face. I managed to slip free of her grasp with the greased snow monkey, although my attempt to counterattack with the fist of annihilation failed miserably when she executed a perfect evasive yeti maneuver, and all I ended up punching was air. But then, to my surprise, my opponent made a mistake. She shifted into the unmistakable stance of pangolin death strike, for which the proper response was to drop to the floor and implement a golden jackal leg sweep. So I did it. In fact, it was the finest golden jackal leg sweep I had ever performed. There were 16 separate movements, and I made each one of them perfectly. Only, it didn't work. My opponent didn't perform the pangolin death strike at all. Instead, she nimbly leapt out of the way of my leg sweep and dropped on top of me, driving her elbow into my solar plexus. One moment I thought I was about to win the match, and the next I was pinned. Professor Crandall came down from the stands, clucking his tongue in disappointment.
"Oh, Benjamin, you walked right into that one. In dropping to the floor."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.